doing, Shiloh? Today is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. This is Shiloh Missionary Baptist Church, the Lord's church, where God's love and the word transform lives. And I'm so glad you decided to join us here in the sanctuary for our morning worship. Let us stand, receive our deacons, and join them in morning devotion.
Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're going. No more dying there. We are. No more dying there. We are. No more dying there. We are. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're going to see the King.
Good morning. Our scripture this morning is going to come from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 20 through 30. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 20 through 30. If you're able, we'll ask that you stand in reference to God's word. It reads, when ye come together, therefore, into one place, this is not to eat the Lord's Supper. For in eating, every one taketh before other his own supper. And one is hungry, and another is drunken. What? Have not ye houses to eat, to drink in? Or despise ye the church of God? Shame them that have not. What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you in this? Praise you not. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye, as oft as ye drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink the cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. May the Lord add a blessing to the doers and hearers of his word.
Dear Father, we'd like to thank you once more and again for for allowing us to wake up this morning to see another beautiful day.
Thank you, Lord.
Father God, we'd like to thank you for allowing the blood still run warm in our veins.
Hallelujah.
Now, Father God, we'd like to thank you for your son, Father God, whom you sent down here to die for our sins.
Yes.
Thank you, Father God, for him going up on the cross, shedding his precious blood.
Hallelujah.
That we might see that beautiful day you have set before us. That we might still wake up to see another day. Father God, we like to thank you for watching over the sick and shed in.
Yes,
blessing those, pray that you continue to bless them, Father God. Continue to keep your merciful arms around them.
Hallelujah.
Father God, we pray you bless those who have lost a loved one, Father God.
Yes.
But let them know that your will be done, Father God.
Yes,
even though they might feel the pain in their heart, Father God, but it will not last long.
Yes,
but Father God, if we live our life the way you have them, have us to live it, Father God, we will be reunited with them once more and again. And Father God, we come to pray you to bless this church, Father God, that it might continue to grow in your name.
Hallelujah.
Pray you bless the pastor, Father God, that he might say something, that some sinner might say what I may do to be saved.
Yes,
now, Father God, these even are the blessings at your son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
It's prayer time.
Yes.
It's prayer time. It's really always prayer time. We always stand in the need of prayer. If you don't think you stand in need of prayer, pray for me.
Amen.
This is the hour of prayer that we take a moment during morning worship to come to the altar. We haven't been coming to the altar because of the season of COVID and staying socially distant from one another. And there's so many things going around. They got so many viruses, so many infectious diseases. It makes you wonder, you know, God was just keeping us in the first place, wasn't he?
Amen.
And so we're going to stand where we are. Bring your hearts to the altar. Bring your hearts to the altar, and we're all going to pray. We're all going to pray together, but the Spirit moves me, and if this person doesn't mind, but the Spirit moves me to call this person's name, Sister Eddie Brewer. Would you pray for us this morning? Let us pray with her as she leads us to the throne of grace.
Abba Father,
yeah.
Abba Father,
yeah.
Abba Father, who is the greatest and highest in heaven.
Yeah.
Abba Father, who woke us up this morning,
yeah.
Who watched over us, Father, all night long.
Yeah.
And we were all clothed in our right mind. Father God, you are a great God. You watch over us all. And Father, I just want to thank you for everything you have done. You've been good, Father, through the years that we have been through. You are a great God. Thank you, dear Heavenly Father, for blessing all of us this morning. Father God, you woke us up this morning and we were all clothed in our right mind. And now I just want to say thank you, Jesus, for everything you have done. You've been good, Father, all the way. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You are a great God. You've been good, Father. Help us, Father, in all the sick and the shedding. And I know you have that almighty power. Oh, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. And Father, when we can't do nothing else in this world, we're going to keep on leaning on you, because you are our Father who are in heaven. Thank you, Jesus, for giving us this day. Thank you, Jesus, for waking us up this morning. You didn't have to do it, but you did. Father, we can't do nothing else in this world, we're going to keep holding on to your unchanging hand. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I ask this blessing in the name of Jesus, who has it all, y'all, and never make a mistake. In Jesus' name, let us all say,
amen. 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 Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord in this place. Amen. Thank you, Sister Brewer. Thank you for that soul-stirring prayer.
Because of who you are, I give you glory. Because of who you are, I give you praise. Oh, because of who you are, I will lift my voice and say, Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Any worshipers here today? Come on, help me out. Because of who you are, I give you glory. Because of who you are, I give you praise. Oh, because of who you are, I will lift my voice and say, Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Lord, I worship you because of who you are.
Because of who you are.
Because of who you are, I give you glory. Because of who you are, I give you praise. Because of who you are, I will lift my voice and say, Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Lord, I worship you. Lord, I worship you because of who Jehovah, you're Jehovah Shai, my provider. Jehovah Nisi,
Jehovah Nisi.
Lord, you reign,
Lord, you reign.
Jehovah Shalom,
Jehovah Shalom.
My Prince of Peace,
my Prince of Peace.
And I worship you because of who you are. Because of who you are, I give you glory. Because of who you are, I give you praise. Because of who you are, I will lift my voice.
Lord, I worship you.
Lord, I worship you because of who you are.
Lord, I worship you.
Lord, I worship you because of who you are.
Lord, I worship you.
Lord, I worship you because of who you are.
Come on, put your hands together and give God some praise.
Should I feel discouraged? And why should the shadows come? till my heart feel lonely and long for heaven and home. Since Jesus is my portion, a constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Why should I feel discouraged? And why should the shadows come? Why should my heart feel lonely and long for heaven and home? Since Jesus is my portion, a constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy, and I sing because I'm free. Oh, his eye is on the little sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy, and I sing because I'm free. Oh, his eye is on the little sparrow, and I know, and I know. And I know he watches. He watches me.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you, music ministry. Thank you. There is a word from the Lord today. I thank Reverend Morris for standing in for me last week as I went to visit my mother for her birthday. 87 years old. 87 years young. Still getting around. Moving a little slower than usual, but she's still getting around. It was good to see her and just sit and talk and eat and talk and gain some weight and be mad at myself when I got home. Reverend Morris preached a good word I watched online. I tried to say something at Sunday school, but I guess the system wasn't working. Sunday school was good. Morning worship was good. I enjoyed it with my mother online. He talked about the misinformation of the following. And I want to talk a little bit about that from a different angle this week, about the following. So we're going to turn to Matthew, very familiar chapter 13, Matthew chapter 13. And we're going to pick up at verse number 24. Matthew chapter 13, verse number 24. Not going to keep you long, it's Communion Sunday. Just want to give you a word to carry you through your week. We come to just remind you about what God has said, because I know I got a bunch of Bible scholars in the room, so I can't tell you nothing new. But I just want to encourage you to remember what God has already said in His Word. We're going to pick up verse number 24, read down through 30. This is a parable. It's not a historical telling. And chapter 13 is a group of parables that Jesus is talking about the kingdom. And the word of God reads as this. Another parable put he forth unto them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is likened unto a man which sowed good seed in his field. But while men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares amongst the wheat, and went his way. But when the blade was sprung up and brought forth fruit, then appeared the tares also. So the servants of the householder came and said unto him, sir, didst not thou sow good seed in thy field? From whence then hath it tares? He said unto them, an enemy have done this. The servant said unto him, wilt thou then that we go and gather them up? But he said, nay, lest while ye gather up the tares, ye root up also the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. And in the time of the harvest, I will say to the reapers, gather ye together first the tares, and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. I want to tag this message today, do not disturb. Do not disturb. As I've been growing up, I've heard those words, do not disturb, a lot of times. When I was in college, I remember that, you know, some of you have been to school and you had roommates, and if you did not want to be disturbed, you had a signal for your roommate not to come in the room. Maybe you tied something around the handle of the door, Brother Stanton. Maybe you put a sign or a placard out. I'm not quite sure what you did to let your roommate know, do not disturb. In the corporate world, your manager, he had a sign on his door, you know, at least they used to. Anymore, Sister Wilhite, we work in these cubicles. Don't nobody got no private offices anymore. We work as a collective. And so we used to have signs on our doors that if we didn't want to be disturbed, we would put a sign on our door, do not disturb. When I came to Shiloh, somebody asked me if I wanted a sign for my door, do not disturb. I said, no. I mean, if somebody needs me, whatever I'm doing can't be that important that I cannot be disturbed. I just, you know, sometimes you see that sign and you need to talk to somebody and it's like, do not disturb. Now, it's probably a good thing I know on our smart devices, there's a button on there now that says, do not disturb. And I hope everybody, when y'all come into church, y'all hit that little button that says, do not disturb. Usually, do not disturb means something important is going on and I don't want to be bothered. I don't want to be interrupted. I don't want anything to break my concentration. But sometimes it's about do not be disturbed. Sometimes the things that are going on in the world and going on around us seem to disturb us. But I hear God saying in the text today to remind us that we don't have to be disturbed. There are things going on around us in the world that we live in and the places that we go and the people that we meet that seem like they would disturb us, but God is saying, do not be disturbed. I see in the text here, because I want to give you the context. If you go back to the beginning of verse number 1, it says that Jesus went out of the house. He'd been teaching in the house, but he decided to go out of the house and sit by the seaside or the lakeside. He decides to leave the house and the small group of people he's talking to, he decides to go outside. And when he goes outside, a multitude of people come around. So many people come around Jesus when he goes by the seaside that he gets in a little boat and he pushes away from the shore so he has a platform in order to speak to all the people on the shore. And he begins to teach them in parables. And the most famous of those parables is the parable of the sower. And we know about the sower and the seeds and where the seeds fall. We've heard that so many times. I just want to skip over it. I just want you to know that this is one of the parables that Jesus is teaching to the crowd. But after he tells them about what happens to seeds that are sown, he talks about what happens when a sower plants good seed and somebody else plants some weeds right next to where they planted good seeds. You're out doing good work. You're planting God's word, but the enemy is trying to plant bad seed right next to where you're planting. It may be happening in your own households. It may be happening at your job. It may be happening in the schoolhouse. Every place that you're trying to spread the gospel, the good news, every place that you're planting good seed, the enemy is trying to undermine and plant bad seed. It can be frustrating. It can make you angry. It can make you bitter. I had a member call me the other day, and I was suggesting that they work with a group, and she was like, those are bad seeds. I don't want to work with them. It reminded me that in this kingdom that belongs to God, that we have to live in a kingdom with good and bad. It rains on the just and the unjust. I am reminded that this is God's kingdom and that God is in control. And God in his word has reminded us that in spite of the fact that we would like to live in a candy store, sugar-coated, rose-colored glasses kind of world where there is no trouble, that ain't the place he put us. He lets us know that he has good things for us, but he also lets us know that the enemy is ever present. And that he, in his godly wisdom, in his sovereignty, has decided that what? To let us grow together. Yeah. He says in his word, let me help you understand and let me walk through this text as I move forward fairly quickly. He says to his disciples, number one, I'm teaching you in parables because everybody's going to hear me, but everybody's not going to understand. I'm teaching you in parables because everybody is together, but this word ain't for everybody. I'm revealing God's truth to everybody, but everybody's not going to receive it. Many people see without seeing. Many people hear without understanding. And the parable is designed so that those who God intends to understand, they get it. My sheep hear my voice, and no other voice will they follow. My sheep understand what I'm talking about, and what I've got to say to my sheep is for my sheep. Everybody has met some people who you've shared God's word with, but I come to comfort you. Don't beat your head against the wall with people who just don't seem like they get it. God is the only one that can save people. We introduce people to Christ. We help people find Christ. But if somebody doesn't want to find him, if somebody doesn't want to seek him, if somebody's not interested, don't beat your head against the wall. God says some people will never change. It's unfortunate. And if you think about where Jesus was, and when Jesus was teaching, the Pharisees were there. The Sadducees were there. The religious elite were there. And they had already made a decision and plotted about how they were going to kill Jesus. We're in chapter 13, but if you just flip back to chapter 12, you see as Jesus is teaching that the Pharisees hold a council meeting, and they decide then, we got to get rid of this Negro. He's going to be nothing but trouble for us. They'd already decided that Jesus was a problem, and that he was going to be a problem until they got rid of him, and they were plotting when and where they could take him out. And so as he continues to teach, Jesus is aware, an all-knowing God is aware of who is in his presence, and he's trying to get the word to the people so that they don't become targets too. He understands how people who play mind games and tricks, how they try to get people on their side, try to get people to become part of their mob and their group, get them to join them, how the enemy infiltrates even the house of God. It's what the enemy does. What God says, it's my kingdom. But even in my kingdom, the enemy is stirring up trouble. But it's okay, God says. I know you're a servant of the God, and the servants of God, the servants of the household, come to the owner and say, look, we see that the enemy has planted these weeds, and we understand that they don't belong. How about if we go get rid of them? How about if we have a crusade to weed out the troublemakers? Sometimes that's our desire, is to attack the troublemakers and cause conflict and division. But God says, not in my kingdom. That's not the role of the servants of God. The servants of God are supposed to spread the good seeds, supposed to water and be prepared for the harvest. He says, don't worry about it. I've got some people at the right time, at the right moment, they'll handle it. But for right now, do not disturb. See, the thing about wheat and tare is they look very much alike. They grow up, and they can grow up together. And I know Brother Gilbert, he's an agriculturist. He probably knows the difference between wheat and tare. He could probably identify. But everybody who hasn't been a planter and put stuff in the garden can tell the difference between something that is sprouting that will bloom and provide fruit versus something that is a useless weed. There are some days when I plant some stuff out here in front of the church. Walter Boyd, he's not here today, but he keeps telling me, man, that looks like a big weed to me. I just want to go cut it down. I'm like, Walter, just wait. Just wait a little bit longer. It grows tall, and it has leaves on it, and it looks like a huge stalk of nothing. But eventually, it blooms. It blooms these beautiful white flowers. They blossom and they're fragrant and they actually look beautiful. But in the meantime, they look like nothing. And so God is saying that when you look at these weeds or equate them to people, when you examine people in the sanctuary, when you examine people in the street, when you examine people at your job or at your school, and it looks like they're nothing, God still be working on them. Just because they haven't bloomed yet doesn't mean it's time to pluck them up. It's not time to push them aside. Just because you got to understand that in us who are believers is something called the Holy Spirit. Everyone who has accepted God's word and him as his, their salvation has received this Holy Spirit on the inside. And this Holy Spirit is not like a magic wand. It just doesn't turn you overnight. You don't go into the water and come up out of the water looking like you're a new man. The Holy Spirit works in us over time. Like a plant that grows. And the Bible in Galatians tells us that the fruit of the Spirit, and that the Spirit is trying to develop fruit in us so that we look different than what we started. You see, I serve a God who knows how to change people. We say love God, love people, make disciples, but we believe in transformation. We believe that God's word and God's love can transform everybody. Saul was a mess. You know Saul in the Bible. He became Paul. You know him as Paul, but originally he was Saul, and he was a persecutor. And if God can change Saul, who hated Christians, who murdered Christians, who tracked down and drug Christians before high councils, if God can change Saul, he can change me. There's nobody God can't touch. There's nobody God can't deal with. And we have got to stop writing people off because we think they're too mean and evil to know God. Yeah, we look pretty good next to him. But God's not finished with you, and he's not finished with me, and he's not finished with them. And God said it's not your role to judge them. It's your role to grow up with them. And as we grow up with them, we can help them change and bear fruit. And the importance of bearing fruit is that one day God is going to come for judgment. And he says right here in the word, as he explains it, as he explains the parable to his disciples, because you know there comes a point where you know he gave the explanation of the sower, but they had to ask for the explanation of the tare. I guess they wanted to be sure they weren't tare and that they really were wheat. They wanted to know, what do you mean about being reaped at the harvest? Because Jesus Christ is explaining that there is going to come a time where God himself will send his angels to separate the weeds from those who bear fruit. He will send at the harvest time to pull up the weeds. I know y'all waiting for that day, aren't you? Because you're tired of living around evil. You're tired of, I'm doing my very best not to be disturbed by the evil that is in our community. I'm doing my very best to be concerned but not disturbed about the violence in our community. I'm trying to be peaceful, at peace with what's going on with this war in Ukraine and Russia. I'm trying to be at peace with this silent war that's going on with China. If you didn't know, we are having a silent economic war with China that could erupt into something even worse. Around us, I'm trying to be at peace and not be disturbed by the climate change that's going on in our world We're enjoying summer in winter. California is enjoying a real winter. It's snowing in Texas and California, and we get torrential rains and floods. And some people think there's no such thing as climate change. But all you got to walk outside on a March day and see how beautiful it is. The daffodils are blooming at the beginning of March. Trying not to be concerned and disturbed, because I know a God who's in control. I know a God who says, I got this. You don't need to worry about this. I've given you an assignment, and if you would just carry out your assignment, I got the rest. I will handle the evil that's in the world and remove it at the right time, in the right way. Because if I left it up to y'all, y'all mess everything up. Y'all would destroy the world and the plan that I have. So please leave it up to me to separate the wheat from the tare. Please leave it up to me to handle the big stuff if you would just handle the little stuff. I've given you something in your hands. I've given each of you something in your spirit. I've given each of you a gift and a talent. I've given each of you something to use to impact this dark world, to shine your light in this world. And all I need you to do is shine your light. If you would shine your light in dark places, then I could see some change maybe in some of those weeds. You see, what God's plants need are light. Everything that lives needs light and water. Everything that grows needs light and water. And some of us are called to be the light, and some of us are called to be the water. And God is using each of us in the lives of other people to make a difference and an impact in some way in the lives of other people. We have to be careful to understand chapter 13 is mostly trying to make us focus and understand that this is God's kingdom. That we are living in the midst of God's kingdom. And what he makes clear, if you read the entire chapter 13, is that some of us are waiting to go to God's kingdom. Some of us think that only God's kingdom exists in heaven. But if you read chapter 13 and the way he talks about what's going on and about how he plants in this world and how he's going to harvest this world, then you have to know that he's talking about a kingdom right here. And if he's talking about a kingdom right here, it means our responsibility is right now. Our responsibility to God in his kingdom has already begun. Because when we get to that last place, that is a place of rest. The place we're in right now is a place of work and service. But where we're going, when we get home to that glorious place, that place they call the place of no more, it'll be a place of rest. When God, Jesus himself, comes for us and delivers us out of this dark world, when our lights have burned and burned so long and so hot that now they've burnt out, it is God himself who will deliver us into heaven to be with God himself forever, eternally, because we bore the fruit of the Spirit, the fruit of love, the fruit of peace, the fruit of joy, the fruit of kindness. You must bear some fruit so that when the reaper comes, He will recognize you. Don't look like a weed. Don't be God's child and not bear any fruit. You'll look just like a weed. And I don't want the reapers to mistake you, because you simply chose God but didn't live for God and bear the fruit of the Spirit. Because there is going to come a time where the reapers will separate the fruit to the barn and the weeds to the fire. And when it comes time to go home to the place that God has prepared for us, you want to be recognized by Jesus himself. Love God, love people, make disciples. We extend the invitation to Christian discipleship. You can come. You can come today.
We offer Christ to you, oh my sister.
God's kingdom is always open.
He will give you brand new life. New life abundant.
You might need a home, a place where you can grow, where you can be planted. And you can work from where others are here to tend and serve, and you are wanting to serve alongside of them.
We offer Christ to you.
You've never been baptized, but you know that God has saved you. Baptism is an outward expression of an inward experience. You know that the Lord has come into your life. He has saved you and delivered you from sin. He's paid the price, the penalty for your sin. You can come.
Come on to Christ.
Amen, amen, amen. It's giving time, saints. It's giving time. We don't come around and give anymore. We give at the end of service. There'll be somebody holding a basket at the end of service. But we know some of you have already mailed it in, dropped it in the mailbox, dropped it in the tithing box, even given online. Givelify. We use Givelify as our online platform. So if you want to give online, look for Shiloh Missionary Baptist Church. Look for the beautiful purple and gold logo. Amen? Because there are a lot of Shilohs, so look for the one at 3801 Forest Manor. And so you can give online. But most of all, I want to say thank you. Thank you, Shiloh, for the way you give. Because you give from your heart. You don't give out of obligation. You give from your heart. And we thank you for your love for God and for ministry. For some of us, we get to the age where the best we can do is give. We don't run like we used to. We don't fly like we used to. But we still can give like we used to. Matter of fact, some of us, the older we get, the better we can give. Amen? Amen. Somebody will understand that as they get older. I remember the days I lived on $200 a week. I'm glad those days are gone. Amen. Lord have mercy. Amen. But he kept me even then. Kept me even then. But I'm glad I'm not there anymore. Amen. Father God, we come right now to say thank you. Thank you for another day's journey. Thank you for your love, your kindness, your grace, and your mercy. Thank you most of all for salvation, for the love you showed through your Son, Jesus Christ, and the sacrifice on the cross, creating a way that we might have a right to the tree of life. Jesus said, "Those who believe in me, who accept me, shall never perish." And we hold fast to that promise, Lord, and we say thank you. And because of your love, because of your grace, because of your mercy, we continue to serve you, Father, in this kingdom, in this world, Father, with your people, whom you love each and every one of them, all the way until the end, Father, when you shall call your angels to reap a new harvest, Father. But it is up to you when that time is. But in the meantime, strengthen us, encourage us, give us wisdom, guidance, and knowledge so that we are able to do just what you've called us to do. No more and no less. In Jesus' name. And as we come to depart from this place, but never to depart from your presence, may the love of Christ, the grace of God, the communion of the sweet Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with each and every believer. And all of the believers said, amen, amen, amen. 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 Go in peace.